Father, we thank you today. We come before you with humility. We come with an humble heart. We come in recognition of who you are in Jesus' name, for how great a God you are. Oh, you were great in your creative acts. You created, you spoke, and Lord, amazing things happened. Yes. Then, Father, we see down through the time and man's plight of sin, you still remain good because you're merciful. No, you don't condone the sin, but you love the sinner. And you provided a means of salvation through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm so glad God had a plan. And in that plan that you have, Lord, it included your goodness today. You didn't come to pour wrath and fury upon us. You came to, Lord, bring us out. Bring us in because you're such a good God. You're so good that you sent your only begotten Son to die on a cross, to bear our sins, to bleed for us, to die for us. And thank God to arise and come up out of that grave on the third day for us. And all because you are a good God. And even when we in life, beyond things that happen, Lord, we're facing in life, the struggles, the trials, the places of pain and sorrow and grief and hurt and difficulty, still in the midst of that, you're the God who is still good. Because you're the God who loves us, provides for us, and helps us. We just want to declare how great a God you are. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. Now, Father, I pray that you will just overwhelm us in this service today, and you shall and you will, if we will draw our attention to you. If we're going to sit here today and watch a clock and, Lord, try to count the minutes and try to just get through and think, man, I'll be glad when this is over and I can go eat and whatever else and rest the rest of the day. Lord, that's not why we're here. We're here today to declare the goodness of God in our worship, in our praise, Lord, in everything that is accomplished here today, whether it's music or whether it's a message or an invitation or whatever today. May the Lord be lifted up. May the Lord be exalted. May you today be extolled for how great a God you are. And we just pray that, Lord, even when we're in the struggles of life, there's a God who brings triumph. Encourage the hearts of your people and speak to them mightily today through the power of the Holy Spirit. Have your way. We rebuke every force of evil that would come against us, every oppressive act that Satan tries to dredge up against us, everything that we are feeling today in our lives. Maybe many are here tired or whatever. Just so many things that can sap us and draw our attention away. Lord, we throw all that aside today and we look to Jesus. And we praise you for what you're going to do in this house of worship today and declare it done in all the praise we give to you, for it's in Jesus' blessed, glorious, wonderful name we do pray. And all God's children shouted, amen. Amen. Let's get ready for a great time in God's house.
treasured just one sin. Seeking forgiveness when your heart knows within. Our God will not judge us on how big or how small. He looks for Calvary's blood to cover it all. Oh, the blood covered it all. Love has no boundaries since death paid in full. Jesus knew in the beginning that man would surely fall. Of his precious blood covered it all. Try to imagine how this miracle took place. Love beyond measure, our God's amazing grace. Sometimes when we're weary, we might stumble and fall, but just one drop of his precious blood covered it all. Oh, the blood, the blood. Surely fall, just one touch of his precious blood covered it all. Jesus knew in the beginning that man would surely fall. I'm glad my Savior's precious blood, yes, it was his precious blood that covered it all, covered it all.
Was shouting, crucify. Couldn't have come from these lips of mine. The dirty shame was killing me. It would take a miracle to wash me clean. Then I read. Like lightning hit my veins, my dead heart began to beat. The breath of God fill my lungs and the Holy Ghost awaken. Yeah, the Holy Ghost awaken me. Red, the red letters and the ground began to shake. Became a free man that day. For God so loved the whole wide world, sent his only son to die for me. Arms spread wide for the whole wide world, his arms spread wide where mine should be. Jesus changed my destiny. Thank you, God, for red letters in the ground began to shake. The grace of God.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. Coming down. Why don't you greet folks? Let them know you're glad to see them in the house of the Lord. Hey, how are you today? Hope you're doing well. Welcome to GBC, Gethsemane Baptist Church, located right here in the heart of beautiful Lynchburg, Virginia. 411 Blue Ridge Street, not hard to find. One block off of Lakeside Drive. Hey, friend, we're near the College Lake. Not too hard to locate us. We'd love for you to come and be a part of the good things that God is doing here. Today we're continuing in our series on the book of Romans. We're delving into chapter 5 and we're dealing with the benefits of grace, which it's all good, it's all God. So it's going to be a great blessing. We are thankful for you tuning in to Alive TV, and thank you for watching this program and all the other church programs and music and other events that we try to put on television to bless you. And we are thankful to the Lord that we have that opportunity to bring you the good news of Jesus. Amen. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let's sing along, praise God, and worship him today. For he and he alone is worthy of our praise. May you be blessed today. Thank you for tuning in. God bless you.
Attraction for me, for the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. In that old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and he died to pardon and sanctify me. Oh, sing this morning. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross until my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. The chorus again. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross until my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a
Once more.
So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
You may be down and feel like God has somehow forgotten, that you are faced with circumstances that you can't get through. Right now it seems that there's no way out and you're going under. But God's proven time and time again he'll take care of you, and he'll do it again.
The benefits of grace. And you said, well, preacher, you've really been talking a lot about grace and gospel, grace and gospel. Well, isn't that what the Bible is about? And certainly that is what Paul is drawing our attention to here in Romans 5. I mean, Romans 5, 1 through 5, we're actually stepping into the book of chapter 5 of the book of Romans today. The book of Romans is a critical study of salvation. And this really will help to solidify your walk with God in salvation, to grip you and to give you a better understanding of what you have in the Lord. I believe so many Christians do not understand salvation. And so this happens, and it does for several reasons. Reason number one is they have not been adequately taught. That so many churches today are not teaching and preaching the Word of God. They're giving people false hopes and false ideas. And people today are walking around, well, I don't know if I'm saved or not. And I thought I got saved and I got to get saved 25 more times. No, you don't. If you meant business on the first time, let me tell you what, God has already taken care of that. So you need today to listen. I give you the Word of God. You need to receive the Word of God and let it apply to your heart and your life. The second reason is they have never considered the truth and scriptures for themselves. Today you need to receive the message of God's Word and today stand on what God said. So therefore, Christians spend their time feeling God is disappointed with them or God is mad with them and they feel like, well, God doesn't care for me anymore. I don't know where you got that at, but let me tell you, you need to go back and forget that because God does love you. And God is a merciful and a gracious and a good God. And yes, we do miss the mark. And yes, we do sin. And yes, we do fail in life. But that doesn't mean today that God doesn't love you anymore. Or God has kicked you out of the family. Or God today doesn't care for you any longer. He does. So, you know, you look at these things today and you need to, we become so aware of our failures that we fail to experience the love of God. Therefore, we find ourselves living our lives and we live in a diminished joy and we live a weaker life. Do you really think that's what God wants for you? No, He does not. What God wants for you today is to do exactly what Nehemiah said, that the joy of the Lord is your strength. I'm going to tell you, you're never going to get this when you're walking around and you're defeated, depressed, and discouraged all the time. You're not going to experience the true joy of the Lord. And you're going to experience the true joy of the Lord when you realize, recognize, absorb, and embrace, and involve in your life what God has done in your life in birthing you into His family and making you who you are in Christ Jesus. Amen. So this verse by verse, chapter by chapter, study, I think becomes very essential for us in the church. Today we're going to dive into Romans 5, which I think is very critical, and I think it's very important that we get it right. We forget that our lives depend upon oxygen until we're deprived of it. And you know, it's kind of the same thing with grace, isn't it? The past, the present, even the future of the Christian life is a result of us being dependent upon the grace of God. Now, I know that there are acrostics and there's the little catchy phrases and all these things pertaining to G-R-A-C-E, but I'm not into that. What I want to tell you today, grace is the very air that we breathe as believers in Christ Jesus today. You've got the breath of God on you, in you, and God is working through you today. If you are physically able, would you stand for the reading of God's Word? I know today that you'll be blessed as we look into the first five verses of chapter 5 of the book of Romans. These are really potent verses because listen to what Paul says. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulation also. Well, I lost some of you on that one, didn't I? We glory in trials and troubles and valleys, is what Paul is saying. Also knowing that tribulation worketh patience. And patience, experience, and experience, a four-letter word I love, hope. Amen. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. Praise the Lord for the reading of God's words. You may be seated. Amen. I want you to understand today, it is my desire that the Spirit of God will speak to your hearts and change your lives today. You say, well, preacher, I'm already saved. I'm in. And so, you know, I really don't need this. Yes, you do. You really do. You need to be changed. You need to get more dedicated, more filled with God's Spirit, more on fire for God. I've never met a Christian that's everything they could, should, and ought to be for God, including myself. Today, we all have room for growth, don't we? We have room for improvement. We have room to live for God greater and better in our lives. Romans, in chapter 5, Paul is giving us kind of an emotional breather here, if you would, from the heaviness that we have taken from chapter 1 all the way up through chapter 4. It's some heavy stuff that we dealt with. I mean, God just kept pounding that issue about judgment, kept hitting that issue about our lives and how that we are going to stand before a God of judgment. But in Romans 5, 1 through 5, we find Paul is inviting us to celebrate. Man, I love to celebrate, don't you? I said, I love to celebrate, don't you? You know, if you're quiet, it takes me twice as long to preach a message. So keep that in mind. The quieter you are, the longer it takes. Amen. The quieter you are, the slower I talk. Amen. So, you might want to think about that. Oh, yeah, now we got something going. We can celebrate the marvelous benefits, and I was just messing with you. We can celebrate the marvelous benefits that we are given when we put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul, his phrase, therefore being justified by faith. Paul does in three words, justified by what? By faith. Say those three words with me. Justified by faith. What we have covered, realizing this is exactly what Paul is talking about, that we're justified by the faith that we have in Christ. So praise the Lord today that God is giving us a solution of and to our sin problem. I'm glad my sin problem is solved. Amen. And here's what we get in the fact that he has solved our sin problem. Number one, we've got the perfect life of Jesus, and thank God he lived a perfect life, that he could work a perfect work of salvation in you and I. Secondly, I think about the atoning death of Jesus, that his death today, thank God his blood atoned for us and made a way where we had no way. Thirdly, is the resurrection. Folks, that's what our Christianity is based upon, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ and what he has done for you and I. So because of Jesus, listen, oppressive religion today is taken out of the picture. A lot of folks are trusting, well, I got religion. Well, we sang an old song, give me that old-time religion, give me that old-time religion, give me that old-time religion, it's good enough for me. Well, is it really? If it's not making much change in your life, it must not be too good. If it's not drawing you closer to Christ, it must not be working. See, I'm not about religion, folks. I'm not a religionist. Oh, my God. Preacher. I'm about relationship. Because Jesus came not to establish religion. He came to establish relationship. And we can only have relationship with him and through him in his blood today. So the way we are made right with God is through our faith in the fact that what Jesus has done, completed, and sealed, signed, and given to us today, there's nothing I can add to it. There's nothing I can take from it. There's nothing that I can manipulate with it. It's just the fact that you receive it and your life is changed. And now you got something to give God glory, honor, and praise about. Amen. Hallelujah. Several points I want to show you here today, but first, we're not going to let you off without the theme. Thank God for the theme. So this theme is very simple, but very profound. Faith in Christ, oh man. Faith in Christ makes life worth living. Well, preacher, I'm just existing. Oh, really? Are you having fun? Well, preacher, I'm just trying to get by. Oh, are you having fun? Well, preacher, I'm just like the cat in the commercial. I'm hanging in there, baby. Oh, boy. You are really an exciting person to be around, aren't you? Amen. I'm glad that's not the way it works. I'm glad Jesus Christ, look, Jesus Christ makes life worth living. Amen. You don't have to get by, get through, hang on, hang out, all that other crazy stuff. You today can be excited because life is worth the living in Christ. Amen. Praise God. Let me give you some points here. Maybe it'll help you in your walk with God. Number one, when we are in Christ, we have a family we can count on. Amen. So Paul gives and he uses pronouns, and if take you back to school, well, I'm not going to give you an education in that, but he uses pronouns in Romans 1 through 5, as a matter of fact, and over you'll find this word we, W-E. So here's some examples. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Here's another one. We have access by faith into this grace. Thirdly, he says we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. So look at that and realizing that today, Paul is talking about a family, a community of faith. You know what? Thank God we are part of the greatest family that is on planet Earth today, and it's the family of God. You may say, well, I got a great family, earthly family, and great lineage and all. That's fantastic, but let me tell you what, you got an even greater family in Christ, amen. You've got an eternal family today. You've got people that care for you, love you, and people that will weep with you, people that will laugh with you, people that will pray with you, people who care about you. That's what the community of faith, that's what we are about as Christians. That's what we are about as a church, amen. That we are indeed today a family, amen. And so therefore, do you realize that we live in a society today that really seeks to separate us because of the differences that we have? There's so much in our nation today presently that is seeking to divide us. In every avenue, in every area, in every walk of life, it seems like the idea today of Washington is to create division amongst people. Well, I'm glad today there's no division in the family of God. We're on the right side, the winning side, amen. So if you're not careful, you then will lose sight of the spirit of the gospel of Christ. Listen, the gospel is the singular thing that will unite us. It's the gospel that brings us together. It's the gospel that holds us together. It's the gospel that gets us through together, amen. So when you are purchased by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, you are brought into a family. Look around. Wave to your family. Amen. This is your family, friend. A family of people who have been regenerated and redeemed by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. In this family, because of the great grace of our God today, He has made our differences even beautiful. Amen. Yeah, we're all different people, aren't we? We come from different backgrounds. We have different vocations. We live in different houses. We drive different cars. We even use different kinds of soap and perfumes and all this other crazy stuff. But see, there's a common denominator, and that common denominator in us today is Christ Jesus. Amen. We may look different. Some of us have white hair. Some of us have brown hair. Some of us have black hair. And some of y'all don't have no hair. Well, I'm not even going to go there. Amen. What's that old saying? Beauty is in the eye of the beholder, right? Amen. We all look different. We all live, work, different. But listen, Christ has brought us together through the cross. Through His blood, we're family, and we stand with each other. We care for one another today. So realizing that even in our differences, God brings beautiful things out of those things today. So affections are changed with the love of God. Greater love hath no man than this, that Christ laid down his life for you and I. It's the love of God that transformed, changed, and worked a work of regeneration within us today to make us who we are. Are we perfect? No, we're not. Have we reached a place of perfection? Or have we achieved today the thing of what we could, should, and ought to be? No, we haven't. But praise God, I'm glad he's still working on me. I'm glad he's still working on you. And thank God it's the love of God that constrains, that grips, that holds, that brings us together. And praise God, it's going to be the love of God that one day is going to take us up together. And we're going to see him face to face and behold his glory. And there's going to be a shouting time in heaven. Amen. Praise God because of the love of God. Praise God for his love. So realizing that today, that means today that we walk with each other in pain, because life brings a lot of pain, doesn't it? When we hurt, we walk beside one another. When there are shortcomings in somebody's life, we don't kick them out. We're patient and we love them and pray for them. If somebody offends us, we're quick to forgive them. Because you know what? There's not one of us in this room that's perfect. And you have disappointed people, and I have too. And we've been disappointed by people too. But man, I'm not walking around holding that stuff. Listen, hallelujah. I'm glad God's a forgiving God. And if God is a forgiving God, I better learn that principle in my life and to be a forgiving person, to be blessed of the Lord. So, you know, there's a certainty today that we have about this gospel that comes through us. This, the us of the gospel must transcend out to others and out there to reach other people in Christ. So if you claim Jesus as your Lord today, then God is your Father. Amen. Our Father which art in heaven. Oh, I'm glad he said our Father. That means he's just not my Father. He's just not your Father. I'm glad he's our Father today, because then that makes us all in the same fatherhood of God by the process of salvation. And therefore today we now experience him not only as Father, but we experience him as Abba Father. Amen. Amen. And all these great Christians around you today are brothers and sisters in Christ. Amen. Amen. If you're a brother and sister in Christ today, we then are to go to great sacrificial lengths today to love each other in spite of differences and all the other issues that come up in life. So faith in Christ makes life worth living. And we have a family that we can count on. Amen. Secondly, in Christ we have a peace that we can live with today. You know, this is found in verse 1. Verse 1 is just absorbed with so much information for us. Peace with God is not something that you earn. You can't get it anywhere except from God. So as a matter of fact, we cannot even make peace with God. I hear people say, well, I'm going to make my peace with God. Oh, well, tell me how you're going to do that. Verse 1 is saying, and let me bring you to that in a moment. Verse 1 is saying, since we have been justified by faith, that's how we have peace with God. Amen. Justified by faith. You know what the word justified means? It means everything that was against you, all those past sins, all that degradation, all that shame, all those things that your life was tainted and torn with. Thank God by justification, God removes it and gives you a new relationship with him. Whatever was in your past, glory to God, it's gone. But I used to be, you ain't no more. In Christ, well, you know, don't give no glory to the devil for how much you drank, smoked, sniffed, shot up, whatever else you did. Don't give no glory to God to that. I mean, to the devil for that. Give glory to God that you have been pulled out of that. Amen. You've been delivered from that. You've been set free from that. And if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm free. Not by a government, not by a person, by the person of the Lord Jesus Christ and his blood through the cross. That's why I'm free today. Hallelujah. And you know what? That freedom then gives me a great peace in my heart and my life. Man, you know, I can go to bed tonight, fall asleep. The dog gets in his little bed. He pulls the covers over his head. And I tell you, there's peace in that room. Amen. He said, your dog really do that? Yes, my dog really does that. He's got his own bed. He's got his own covers. And he knows how to pull them up over it. One time I tried to tuck him in, and I wound up almost losing my thumb over it. That wasn't that long ago. Verse 1 is saying, since we've been justified, that's what gives us the peace that we have with God. We all today, listen, we have peace with God, not because of something that you and I have done, but realizing that we have peace with God because of what Jesus has done. If you're in search of peace today, I'm telling you, He's the Prince of Peace, and He will abundantly shed it upon you. When I say peace with God, I'm saying God's grace and God's love today overflows in your heart, in your life. And so the peace that brings forgiveness today, restoration, is all through the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you've never experienced that, His arms are open, His hands extended, and He's offering that to everyone today that's in this place. Jesus has made peace by the blood of the cross. Peace with God is not the same thing as the peace of God. And let me tell you, you're never going to have peace of God until you have peace with God. And they are related because you cannot have peace of God until you have the peace that you need with God. Hope I didn't confuse you. The peace of God is that inner sense today of wellness as you're going through the difficulties of life. Listen, your biggest problem is not your anxiety. It's not your worry. Your biggest problem is the wrath of God that has been revealed from heaven today on all ungodliness. And if you're lost today, you are facing that. And it's going to cause you to go to hell when you die. And it's going to cause you to spend your eternity in the lake of fire. Folks, it does not have to be. Today, you can receive Christ. You can be changed by Christ. You can be delivered by Christ. What you need today is the peace of God that is only possible today through the faith that we have in the Lord, that He provides it. Peace with God means that God's not foreign. God is now our Father. Amen. So if you have the peace of God, God is a friend and not an enemy. Amen. So when you have peace with God, you receive the love of God, and thank God the wrath of God is gone. So therefore today, when you have peace with God, you therefore now you have joy and not worry. Isn't that good to know? What are you here with today? I'm worried myself to death, preacher. I'm just overwhelmed and I'm depressed and I know that comes with life, but it doesn't mean you got to stake your tent out and live there. The joy of the Lord is what? Your strength. So you have confidence, not fear. You have resolve, not anxiety. So when you have peace with God, you have grace and not guilt. That's what God does for us. Peace with God means every drop of judgment, every anger that God had, every punishment that you were going to receive, everything God that He feels about sin and His justice demands, thank God it's all poured out on Jesus at the cross. Because of what we have, Jesus, and what He has done on the cross, there's no anger left against God's children. Now, all God's children receive grace. All God's children receive forgiveness. And all God's children receive restoration and peace. That is given to us by faith if you will believe God for it. Third point, in Christ we have a grace that stabilizes us. You know, some of you, man, I'm telling you, every time the wind blows, you're shifting back and forth. You have instability in your life. You've got unsurety. I mean, something come along, you just, and I mean, we all have experienced this, and I'm not beating you up about it. I'm just telling you, we let stuff just absolutely slip us up and lay us flat on our back or flat on our face. Because of Jesus, we've obtained access to the grace of God. And so Jesus takes a hand and the hand of God, and Jesus brings us together at the cross through His blood. So there is one mediator between God and man, and that is the man Christ Jesus. Through Jesus, by faith today, we have gained access today into the grace which today will cause us to rejoice. Hebrews 4:16, you can come now boldly unto the throne of grace. Why? Because you got access. You're not down, defeated, and dismayed. You're delighted in the Lord. Amen. You got reason to rejoice. Paul said, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Amen. If you're not in Christ, none of these promises of God are going to apply to you, because you've never come through the door of grace. You've never come by grace through faith. And God's offering that to you today. If you're not saved, he today says, come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden, I'll give you rest. Today he will receive you. He will change you. He will save you today by his grace. And so if you're in Christ, you know what? Then all these promises that I'm telling you about are, as the word says, are Y-E-S and A-M-E-N. Yes and amen. Every promise of God is for you. It belongs to you. So the promise that Paul brings before us, that we today can only do this by standing in the grace of God. You don't fall in and out of grace. You're covered by grace. You're in. Well, I got lost. Oh, did you? How did you do that? So how'd you take yourself out of God's hands? I really would like to know, because you can't do it. And I can't pull you out either. And the whole church, we can't pull you out of God's hand if you're in Christ. The devil can't take you out. Stop believing that garbage, rubbish, trash from hell. Take the trash out. Start understanding what you've got in Christ. And it all came by the avenue, the conduit, by the cross of grace today that we have in the Lord. Stop wrestling with stuff that's already been settled by God through his Son Jesus at the cross. Amen. Hallelujah. There's a harness. Let's look at it this way. You see these folks walking around today and they got kids. It really amuses me. They're walking around and it's just funny, the kids doing all this because the kid's strapped on them right in front of them. I mean, you know. The kid's not looking at mama or daddy. The kid's looking out there. So here goes the parent. Here goes the baby. I'm thinking, this is about the craziest thing I've ever seen. You know what's holding that baby? Listen, no arms. It's a harness. It's an elaborate process that's hooked around a person's body, clicked up, tightened up, cinched up, and that baby couldn't get out if that baby wanted to. Oh, I'm telling you right now, that's called a harness. Now look at it in a spiritual sense. You today have been harnessed to God by Christ. Amen. Woo! I'm just going where Jesus goes. Man, wherever he leads, I'll go. Whatever he directs, that's what I want. Whatever God, because I'm harnessed to the Lord. Amen. Amen. Give him some praise. You've got a harness around you that's holding you by the strength of your heavenly Father. And if you're in God, there's nothing that can take you away from him. Last thing today, let me give it to you real quick. In Christ, we have a hope that keeps us going. You know, it is so easy to quit. I read a post this morning on Facebook. I'm not on Facebook much, but I just clicked on ahead a minute. And the very first post that I saw on the timeline feed was this person that says they hated life, they hated the world, they hated everything. And this person professes to be a B-O-R-N-A-G-A-I-N Christian. And so I'll probably hear about this. I don't care. You can shoot me, but you can't eat me. Amen. And he ended by saying, I can't wait till I die. And I said, dude, you better be careful what you wish for. Well, boy, what a great testimony for a Christian. I hate people. I hate everything. I hate the world. Is there evidence in your life? If that's your case, I really question it. Paul said we glory in tribulation. In other words, we rejoice. This is a hard one for you right now, but I want you to get your arms around it. He's saying that when he says that we glory in tribulation, he's saying that we rejoice in the suffering that we encounter, because you're not going to get out of life without it. No, we don't celebrate it. You didn't get up this morning and say, oh, thank God, I'm going to suffer today. No, you didn't do that. We don't want to be in pain. In all reality. What happens because of Jesus, we can rejoice because we are undergoing the struggle that's going to produce a results in our life. See, suffering then produces endurance. Endurance is the ability to stand under pressure. It's not you standing, it's Him holding you up. So therefore, you've got to understand, you're never standing alone. I just feel so alone in life. You're not! You've got the Spirit and the presence of God with you at all times. The endurance will strengthen you. But what endurance produces is something that you and I need in our life. It's called character. God is developing your character today. When you're in Christ and you're grinding through the difficulty and you're going through the strength and the issues that you're facing that's pulling you down, actually what God is doing, He's strengthening your character and He's developing with you today and He's providing for you and He's proving in you and through you that H-O-P-E word that you better latch on to because your hope lies in Christ. Amen. So it makes it possible that you and I today can stand in the middle of whatever we're going through and whatever we're facing and know that it's going to be just fine. Because God's in control. God's in control. You're trusting. Amen. You are trusting that God's going to do something. I believe that. So God will complete what He started in you. He's still working on me. Still working in me. Still working through me. And He who hath begun a good work in you will perform it. So those who trust God by faith in Christ, we are vindicated today because you have hope in Christ Jesus. He is pouring out His love. As I close this morning, listen, draw in on this. He's pouring love out into your heart. And that happens through the person, the presence of the Holy Spirit. God the Father, hear this little plan. God the Father planned your salvation. God the Son accomplished our salvation through the cross. And God the Spirit pours out God's love to awaken our hearts to believe what God has provided. Has your heart been awakened? Has your heart been awakened? Has your heart been awakened? Are you still going through the drudge of life, lost and going straight to hell when God says, there's a better way? And I am that way, the truth and the life. If you'll come to Jesus, He'll save your soul, deliver you, and give you hope. And then you can face life today with the joy of the Lord, which is your strength. Faith in Christ really does what I said earlier. Faith in Christ makes life worth living. Amen. I didn't tell you you're going to be free of trouble. I didn't tell you that. I'm going to tell you that He'll be there for you in the trouble and the trials and the pain and the problems. He'll bring you through. He'll see you through. And you can declare life really is worth the living. Do you have that today? Are you in need of that today? Listen, whatever you're facing, I'm glad you and I can face it with Christ because He's there with us. He's there for us. And He will bring us through. You know what He'll do just as you sang, Andrew? He'll do it again. Yeah. There's examples in this room where He's done it again. I'm a living, walking testimony. He's done it again. And He keeps on doing it. And what the key factor in doing that is, He does it through His grace. Would you bow your heads for a moment? Preacher, I'm not saved. I'm going to hell and I'm lost and I'm concerned about it. And that's not where I want to wind up when I leave this world. Pray for me. If that is your condition, I ask you to do one thing. Slip your hand up right now. I don't care who you are, where you're at. Lift your hand up and say, I need prayer to be saved today. I need to be born again. But how many of you would say today, well, preacher, I am saved, but I got struggles, I got pains, I got hurts, I got problems, I mean, it goes from A to Z, and man, I really need I need God's grace in my life today. Pray for me. Throw your hand up. Throw it up high. Don't be ashamed of it, because in all actuality, we probably all should have our hands up, because I don't know of a human being that's not going through something or facing something. Whatever your need is, I want you to know today, God can handle it. Stand to your feet. Father, we look to you today and we thank you that through the cross, we've been given the blessed hope. We've been given the promise. We have Christ within us and for us and through us. And I just pray today that you'll move on our hearts and our lives and draw us to these altars of prayer today. There are folks in this church right now that need prayer. There are people at the hospital that need prayer. There are folks that are going through struggles, heartache and difficulty and sadness and grief and pain and all the other things that come to us. But God, there's a God who's bigger than that. Help us to come, and Lord, help us to come to the cross. Come to Jesus, for in you today is our hope. It is found in Christ today. By the way of the cross, that's the way we must come. Will you make that approach today? Come on. You raised your hand, you need prayer, you got struggles, you need help. All these things that you're facing in life, you're going to leave like you came, or you're going to leave here today changed. That choice is yours.